This is the story of Air Canada Flight 621. On the 5th of July 1970, an Air Canada DC-8 was on the ground at Montreal, and it was bound for LA, with a stopover in Toronto. The plane took off from Montreal at about 7:12 a.m. EDT, bound for Toronto. The flight was all but normal. Soon they were getting close to Toronto, and the pilots started working on the in-range checklist. The in-range checklist was followed by the before-landing checklist. The before landing checklist walked the pilots through, setting the plane up for a smooth transition to the approach phase. They completed the checklist and the plane turned to line up with runway 32 at Toronto International Airport. The plane flew into the airport. It slowly lost altitude as the huge DC-8 descended from the sky onto the runway. When the plane was at about 60 feet from the runway, the captain said okay to the first officer, and the plane suddenly started to drop. The captain exclaimed as the plane dropped. The captain increased power to stop the sinking plane. He pulled back on the stick as hard as he could. The safety of the plane depended on it. The first officer was profusely apologizing to the captain. He kept on saying, "Sorry, Pete." His apologies were in vain. The captain could not stop the plane. The plane kept sinking and it hit the runway hard. The plane wasn't on the ground for very long, half a second maybe. And then the plane was back in the air. The controller chimed in with, "Air Canada 621, check you on the overshoot, you can contact departure on 199, or do you wish to come in for a mile on 5 right?" The captain said that they were going around and that they were all right, but they were not. The rightmost engine struck the runway and it was ripped from the wing. When the engine was torn away, it damaged the wing of the plane. Fuel leaked through this hole, and soon the wing was on fire. But the crew thought that the plane was in better shape than it was. They decided to circle the airport and to come in for another approach onto runway 32. The plane climbed to about 3,000 feet for attempt number 2. As the plane flew, smoke trailed it, and 2.5 minutes after the touchdown, an explosion rocked the plane. Parts of the right-hand wing rained down on the ground below. Another explosion ripped off engine number 3. Things were bad. A fourth explosion sent more chunks of the wing raining down. The plane then entered a right bank and the right-hand wing started to disintegrate. Flight 621 was no longer controllable. The plane hit the ground at 220 knots and none of the 109 people on board survived. The runway was littered with debris and finding out what happened started there. The plane touched down so hard that it literally ripped engine number 4 off of its mount. Airplane landings are usually smooth. You'd think that tons of metal touching down at tremendous speeds would be a more violent affair, but more often than not, it's controlled and benign. This is because of what's known as a flare. A flare occurs right before touching down. The pilot pulls the nose up and reduces the rate of descent so that the plane touches down smoothly. That did not happen here. Listening to the CVR or the cockpit voice recorder would tell them why. Listening to the pilot, it seemed like any other flight. The pilots were talking about the approach, completing checklists, etc. But when they got to the before landing checklist, the investigators noticed something strange. The pilot skipped the spoiler part of the checklist. So, what's a spoiler? And what does it do? If you've ever sat in the seat overlooking the wing on any modern airliner, you've probably seen a few panels rise up from the top of the wing once the plane's on the ground. Those are what's known as spoilers. What do? In a way, they spoil the airflow over the wing. The spoilers extend into the airflow and they disrupt the airflow. This has two benefits. It greatly reduces the lift generated by the wing and it generates a lot of drag. This is why spoilers are mostly used during landings. An accidental spoiler deployment during the flare would cause the plane to drop out of the sky. They got their answer from the CVR. 25 minutes before the landing checklist, the pilots were having a discussion about the spoilers. The checklist called for the spoilers to be armed at 1,000 feet. Arming the spoilers does not deploy them. It just meant that the computer would automatically deploy them when the plane was on the ground. When the spoilers were armed, the computer would monitor the rate of rotation of the tires, and when the gear was rotating at about 800 RPM, the computer would automatically deploy the spoilers. But certain pilots distrusted this automatic spoiler deployment mechanism. The captain was one of them. He knew about instances where the spoilers deployed uncommanded. He knew about an SAS DC-8 in Norway in 1968, which had spoiler issues, and a Canadian Pacific DC-8 in 1966. But the Canadian Pacific incident wasn't even caused by an erroneous spoiler deployment, but the captain still thought it was due to a spoiler deployment. In addition to that, the spoiler lever was a bit soft compared to the earlier models, so psychologically the pilots did not trust this new lever because it felt different. For this reason, the captain did not want to arm the spoilers during the approach. He preferred to manually deploy the spoilers once the plane was on the ground. The first officer preferred to arm the spoilers during the flare. Neither procedure was approved, but they did it anyway. They had an understanding. When the captain was the one flying, the first officer would deploy the spoilers when the plane was on the runway. And when the first officer was the one flying, the captain would arm the spoilers during the flare. But today was different. The captain was the one flying, and he said, "All right, give them to me on the flare. I have given up." He was expecting some heavy turbulence from a 727 that had just taken off, so he asked his first officer to arm the spoilers on the flare, departing from what they usually did. This is how they flew the approach. Just before touching down, the captain called, "Okay," indicating that he wanted the first officer to arm the spoilers. But, out of habit, he pulled a spoiler lever and deployed the spoilers. The spoilers did what they were designed to, and the plane started dropping. They were at about 60 feet, and the plane started dropping at about 24 feet per second. The captain increased power and pulled back. This reduced their rate of descent to about 18 feet per second, but it was still too much. They hit the runway. After the hard landing, the pilot had two choices ahead of him: go around or continue the landing, come what may. At the point of impact, the plane was configured for a go-around. The plane was pitching up and the engines were ramping to full power, so it made sense for the captain to initiate a go-around. But the crew didn't really have a way to know how much damage their plane had suffered during the landing. They had to go by the severity of the touchdown, and that's not very scientific. Not knowing the damage that their plane had taken, they lifted back into the skies. The damage from the engine left a hole in the wing. Fuel began gushing through the leak. The fuel vapors came into contact with arcing wires, and that started a fire. As they carried out the go-around, the fire got worse and worse, eating away at the right wing till it failed. This accident ultimately came down to the distrust the pilot had in his plane. He thought that the spoilers would deploy on their own. In response to that, the manufacturer made doubly sure that the spoilers would not deploy by accident. They also had to design a system that would allow the safe separation of an engine from the wing. This meant that electrical cables were designed in such a way that if an engine failed and if it separated, it would separate without the wires sparking. And last but not least, the pilots were told to follow the procedures. The saddest part about this crash is that the first officer was cognizant of what he had done. After their hard landing, he kept on apologizing, saying, "Sorry, Pete," over and over. In fact, that was one of the last words he ever spoke. I guess this brings up the question, how much should a pilot trust his plane? Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I'll catch you guys next time. Stay safe.